ever loved could look at me and know that I love you. Anyone who ever dreamed could look at me and know I dream of you. Every time you go away, I always say, this time it's goodbye, dear.
That's right, the beautiful Cilla Black. Don't you love that song? Now, that song was her first number one, and to this day, it is still the number one biggest selling female song. That's pretty impressive, isn't it? And sadly, she has passed away at age 72 in her beautiful home in Spain, but well known as a female presenter and has sung with the likes of the Beatles and Cliff Richard. Yeah, sadly missed, but what an awesome, awesome career. We had to start the day with a bit of Cilla Black anyway. Rightio, kia ora and welcome to Monday the 3rd of August. Today is D-Day, yes, we are out to an hour, that's right, twice a week, Monday and Wednesday. Canterbury Live will now be coming to you for 1 hour, so it's a big show, lots happening. First up though, we have a winner to announce, Three Mad Fiddlers. Yes, happening tomorrow thanks to Opportunity. We had a double pass to give away and the lucky winner is Annabelle Thompson. Congratulations Annabelle, that ticket will be here at reception at CTV for you to collect. And there's lots more where that came from. Woo, and here we go. Ready, Stephen? Yes, get that camera ready. Rightio, number one is The Naked Magicians. A bit of nudity and magic. Ooh, doesn't it sound inviting? At the Machina Lounge at the Christchurch Casino on August 13th and Friday the 14th of August. And you can purchase tickets through the Christchurch Casino website or just pop in there. But we have some passes to give away. Very exciting indeed. Next up, the beautiful Phyllis Brown. We know that she has just a few minutes each week with us. Imagine having an hour with this wonderful lady. It could be yours. Next up, Andy Stankovic. We took mum and dad there last night to Andy Stankovic at the Isaac Theatre Royal. Sensational, absolutely sensational. Next time he comes to town, you must go. Beautiful voice of Elvis. He had 8 backup singers, full brass section and string. It was simply sensational. You could win one of his CDs and Hoyt's movies. There's lots of good movies happening at the moment. And you could go along courtesy of the Hoyt's family. But wait, there's more. Yes, there is. Irishman Dylan Moran, comedian, is coming to Christchurch. Check this out.
Dylan Moran returns live on stage this August. Christchurch 27, Auckland 28, Hamilton 30, Wellington 31.
Your mind is a hive of worms, and worms don't live in a hive, so it already feels unnatural.
Dylan Moran, Off the Hook Live. Book now.
He's crazy. Have you ever seen his program Black Books? Very funny indeed, very black comedy, very black comedy. Well, we have some passes to head along to him. Remember, it's at Horncastle Arena, 27th of August, and you can purchase your tickets through Ticketek. For all of these prizes, really simple, all you need to do is go through to ctv.co.nz. All the details are there and you could be a lucky winner. Don't say we don't give you opportunity to win something. I tell you what, it's all happening here at Canterbury Live. Coming up on today's show, it's an hour, so there's a lot happening. We have George Aranui here from Air Hoa Art. Phil Brady is talking mortgages, that's right. Are they dropping? Are they going up? Some good times happening. And on Friday, I caught up with the Māori and Pacifica wardens about what they've been doing and as of late last week, so some training. And Itta Photography, family portraits, some great, great family portraits. So how long ago was it when you took your family to get a portrait? Too long? Well, then you better be watching. Ira Mitchell-Kirk presents us her new beautiful painting. I think you've got a little sneaky peek of it now. And Gordon was out on location with the National Cross Country Champ, so we catch up with him. But first up, Nicola Frau. I think I need one of these, actually. An Oshie breakfast drink. Have you got one spare there?
Oh, I'm sure there'll be one somewhere.
Yeah. But a good way to start your day.
Yes, well, breakfast, breaking the fast overnight, the most important meal of the day. It's important that you have the right combination in your breakfast. So we've talked before about how important it is, and also the three components that are important there. There's your carbohydrate part, and your protein, and then making sure you get some vitamins and minerals in there, so making sure you have some fruit or vegetables, that sort of thing as well.
So remind us, what are the three essential parts of breakfast?
So those parts could be with your carbohydrate. You might have bread, you might have cereals, something like that. Your protein could be your milk, your yogurt, an egg, peanut butter, bit of a mix of those things. And then, like I say, the vitamins and minerals, so your fresh fruit or vegetables. So today we're going to talk about a smoothie and or a frappe, we like to call it. And quite often that might be just your two components. So you've got your protein, often with your milk or yogurt, that sort of thing. And you might put a banana or some fruit or something in it. But sometimes the carbohydrate part can be missing. So that's what we're going to fix.
Okay, so where do the oats fit into a frappe?
So today we're adding some oats to a smoothie. And the fruit that we're using is frozen bananas. So you know when your bananas start to go brown and you think, oh, no one's going to eat them, what on earth are we going to do with them?
Or banana cake,
of course. then peel them, pop them in a bag in the freezer and freeze them, and they make the most amazing smoothies. If you blend up just one banana per person, just chop it up into chunks and then pop it in the blender, and it comes out like those beautiful frappes that you buy at the coffee shops, just lovely and thick, and it gives it a really creamy texture. The banana just blends in, it's almost like banana ice cream. It's just delicious. And we put the oats into that. So just the ready oats that are sort of ground a bit rather than whole oats, because whole oats would have the texture would be a little bit too crunchy, I think. But so you can put the partly ground oats, about quarter of a cup of those into the blend as well. And it's really tasty.
So absolutely why are gorgeous. Oats a better start to a day than other cereals? Because there's a lot of cereals out there, isn't there, Nicola?
Well, the oats are actually low GI, so they give you a sustained energy release. So they're great to sort of suppress the appetite for the rest of the morning and keep you fuller for longer. And of course, the raw oats are perfectly natural, no sugar added, so they're so much better than some of these other cereals that are often a third sugar or even more than that. So they're really a great start to the day.
And there's lots of other health benefits though of oats, and crikey, they're so cheap.
Absolutely, yes, so saving the budget is one great benefit. But they're also well known for the fibre in them that can help reduce cholesterol, and the fibre also is great for our gut. And for people with diabetes, they're good at helping you manage your blood sugars, particularly type 2 diabetes. So they're quite similar, actually. Last week we talked about chickpeas, and they're really similar in what they're made up of and also the effect on the body. They're both great.
Yeah, just don't mix up
things.
Chickpeas in your frappe.
No,
just
I don't think
they have the same taste. Are they gluten-free?
Well, they actually are gluten-free, but because the way the oats are usually grown in a rotation crop, they're often grown in a crop in an area where it might have been wheat the year before or some other grain that had gluten in it.
Right.
So they're not usually gluten-free unless they've been specifically grown to be that way. So you can get gluten-free oats, but you just have to watch out for them that they've been grown appropriately so that they don't take on that gluten.
And oats, you always think automatically of porridge.
You do.
But these other things you can use them in, isn't
there? Yeah, so you can use them in muffins, you can use them in pancakes, or pikelets, that sort of thing. Obviously, you can make your own muesli. But try them in a frappe, a frozen banana frappe. It's a great way to sort of use them a bit differently.
And can I say, I know it's naughty, but ginger crunch and your oats and your base is actually quite tasty as well.
Ignore what's on top. Well, it changes it to give it higher fibre, so you're making it healthier.
Phew, I've got the clearance for it. Yeah. So after the break, we will be with Nicola on location with her beautiful oaty banana frappe. Gorgeous. Sounds divine. So look forward to that. Remember, Nourish Nutrition Limited, Nourish.org.nz is the website. Fantastic Facebook page. Remember, don't forget to ask questions, Nicola. She loves it. It's health through food. Stay with us because after the break, the beautiful Ira Mitchell Kirk is here. And of course, that wonderful recipe. Get your pen ready. Do you paint much with black?
No.
But a great song though anyway.
Yeah.
Good old Mick Jagger, Rolling Stones. Very cool indeed. Welcome, Ira Mitchell Kirk. Is it time of the month for you
already?
Present us? I know.
Thank you for having me again.
I know, but we've had so many entries and for July's painting it was quite overwhelming really. Wow. Because it was just so beautiful and the new technique you were using.
Yeah.
I think really drew some new audience or new...
I like that.
Don't you think that's cool?
Yeah, I'm trying to find my own voice and that one's really caught people's attention, so that's good.
Yeah, and we have a lucky winner. And the lucky winner for that beautiful July painting is Teresa Howe. Congratulations, Teresa, whether it be in your home or your business, that wonderful painting will be here for you to collect at CTV. Very nice indeed. So let's get into August.
So we've gone a different way this time. This is an impressionist style, loose, and I thought the weather's warming up, I'll do something nice and floral. So there we are.
There you go. So this is an impressionist style.
It's an impressionist style. So it's broad brush strokes in the vein of Monet. And there's also silver leaf in there as well.
I just saw that there.
Yeah, so it gives it a wee bit of sparkle.
So how do you know where to put that silver leaf in? You don't? You don't think about it?
The voices tell me.
No, I don't know. There's no rhyme or reason. You sort of go...
It's highly technical.
There it is. It's great.
Just placement.
It's just amazing. I mean, just in the colourings and the tones that you've used in it, it's just quite beautiful. And the glass, we were just admiring before, the glass vase. When you're seeing through a vase, obviously, but just the way that you actually do it is quite beautiful, isn't it?
That takes a bit of practice, glass. Yeah. That's quite hard to teach people.
To make it two-dimensional. And beautiful. Okay, well, there you are. This is August, and it could be yours. So you've got, well, I'm just going to give you a bit of trivia, actually. Let's talk about August for a moment. I know. Well, just wait there, Ira Mitchell Kirk. We're educating you. Do you know August, the first time in 823 years, 5 Fridays, 5 Saturdays, and 5 Sundays?
I like the extra Sundays.
I know. How's that?
That's good.
That's extra time to enter into this. Yeah. Rightio. A bit of trivia anyway. Now, let's talk about what you've been up to, because it's very cool indeed. You're heading into the rural schools.
Yeah, I grew up in a rural school, so the total amount of people in my school was 30. Mm. And I felt isolated, but this is before internet, of course.
Yeah.
So you were isolated, and now schools have the internet. But I feel psychologically and physically they're still separate from the art world. So I'm going to go and rev them up. That's my mission. And go into schools and say, well, I work as an artist. I came from where you are. It's a good life. You might not be a millionaire, but I love what I do every day. And it gives me an opportunity to give back. So I'm travelling around lots of rural schools and starting in September. And I go and do workshops, often teaching the whole school at once. So 30 kids. That's the whole school.
Wow. And how do you keep them captured?
Oh, just with my charisma? I don't know. Hey, look, you get paints, paper, kids are in.
They are.
Yeah.
All of them.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the thing is, there's no wrong or right in art.
I think that's
a wonderful thing, isn't it? That's how fantastic a medium it is.
And I want to teach them that it's a joyful thing to do, but you can also have a job that's full of joy and make a living. You know, because often I do Skype lessons with children around the world, and they'll say, yeah, but do you make any money? And I'm like, oh, that's so sad at 5-year-old. They're asking me that. Yes, I do, but I also love what I do, and you can do that too.
Getting paid to do what you love.
Yeah.
That's the key, isn't it, really?
That's a dream.
Now, you have a bit of a mantra for your day-to-day work life, and I think it's wonderful. And you share this, I think it's very cool for us to reflect on.
Okay, a third, a third, a third. So my third, the first third is giving. So I do a lot of charity and sharing and networking. Third of actually doing, so at some point in the day I have to get down and paint. And then a third of learning. So learning is be with people that are doing better than you, are higher achievers than you, that have something to teach you. Otherwise, you're always going to be at the same level. So I challenge myself and work with other people, mentors.
I love it. Mm. That is so cool. Okay, give us a one thought then from your artist frame of mind and that we should be thinking about with our art this month.
Well, John, a quote from Picasso.
Oh,
well, there you go.
Well, there we are.
Art sweeps away the dust of everyday life.
I love it. Say it again.
The art sweeps away the dust of everyday life. Because wouldn't it be dull without it?
It would be.
Yeah.
And so would Canterbury Live without you, my lovely.
Oh,
you're
welcome.
And thanks for this beautiful painting for August. And it could
very
be yours.
Welcome.
All you need to do, it'll be up later on, is ctv.co.nz to enter to win. Very cool indeed. Have a fantastic month.
Thank
Look
you.
Forward
you
to
too.
Next time. Now, you heard about the Wanda Frappe. Here it is now, Nicola with Nourish.
Breakfast on a busy morning can be a crazy time, and sometimes you could throw a smoothie together and hope that that's your breakfast all done, but do you sometimes wonder if it's got everything in it that you need? Well, today I'm going to make an oaty breakfast smoothie that has all the components of a really good breakfast to keep you going right through the morning. So you start with some milk. I've got some trim milk here, so trim milk is the one that the Ministry of Health recommend for anyone over 2 should be having trim milk if they're going to be fit and healthy. So I've got the milk in there, our protein component of the breakfast. So your protein component of your breakfast helps you stay nice and full for a long time, and it just helps that fullness last a bit longer. So we're also going to add some extra protein in the form of some yogurt and also some flavour as well. So I've got some beautiful mango yogurt here, but you could have any flavour yogurt that you like, even plain yogurt if that's what you prefer. So just pop a little bit of that in there, just a couple of good dollops. Right, now the next thing I'm going to add is frozen bananas. So this is a great thing to do if you've got brown bananas sitting in your fruit bowl and you think that they're not going to be used by the family, they're not going to eat those in their lunch box or as a snack at any time. I just peel my brown bananas, pop them in the freezer, and they're perfect for this kind of thing. They really make the smoothie lovely and icy and make it a bit like a thick shake as well, because they add a nice texture to the smoothie. So I'm just going to pop actually about 3 small bananas in there, and this is enough for a couple of people. Now my last ingredient that I'm going to add is some oats. So you could add whole oats, but they do tend to be quite a crunchy sort of texture. So the quick oats are the ones to add, but I actually had some of these just in my cupboard. And these are cinnamon flavoured oats. It's just one serve, it's just the quick serve. So I'm just going to pop those in. I'll just show you. So they're just broken up rather than the whole oats. Just pop those in there. And I'm just going to give that a bit of a blend. It just takes a few seconds to break up those bananas as well. So we'll just pop that on for a few seconds. It's looking good, lovely and thick. Lovely. So I'm just going to pour that into a glass, and this could be a great takeaway breakfast. So if the household is in such a rush that breakfast needs to be eaten on the way to school, this is a good one to put in one of those takeaway coffee cups, or even just a disposable cup, any kind of cup that you have that can be disposed of. But I really love these glass sort of jars with the straws. Are really fun. So I'm just going to pop it in there, and you can see that mixture is really lovely and thick. If you wanted to make it thinner, you could just add more milk or just blend that for a little bit longer as well, and that would be fine. So you can see the thickness of the oats and also the banana make it like a lovely thick smoothie. I might just have a taste of it for myself. Oh, that banana flavour is absolutely delicious, and you can sort of taste the texture of the oats, but it's just gives it a lovely thickness and quite a depth of flavour. It's really, really delicious. So something really easy. It's a complete breakfast, this. It has your carbohydrate, your vitamins and minerals from your banana, and also the protein as well. So a complete breakfast, it'll keep you going for the best part of the morning, and a great one to take if you're walking to school, or if you want to have it at home and you've got a fun cup like this, that's great too.
Good. I'm thinking of the kids. It's so great, so easy and so cheap. Radio, stay with us, because after the break, when is the last time you got your family photographed? Too long? Well, you better stay watching. Yes, it is time to get physical. I wonder if Gordon Finlater has his sweatbands on. Hopefully not. We're heading out on occasion with Gordon Finlater. It is the National Cross Country Champs.
Thanks, Andrea. Well, it's a beautiful Saturday afternoon down here at Horswell Quarry for the National Cross Country Championships. Some of the best runners in the country are on display today, representing their provinces.
One of the highlights for Canterbury came in the women's under-20s race, with Rosa Flanagan taking the title for the second straight year. Last year's success meant extra motivation to try and pip last year's winning time.
Since it's sort of like 2K loops, sort of keeping an eye on, they've got a clock up there, keeping an eye on the clock and trying to maintain the pace for the three laps. But yeah, I'm pretty sure I beat my time from last year, so that's always a plus.
The win was made even sweeter for the region, with fellow Cantab Gabby Gray coming home in second spot. And it turns out the podium isn't the only thing the two promising runners share.
Yeah, well, Gabby Gray, yeah, she's my flatmate actually, and got the same coach, so we trained together a bit. So yeah, it's great to have her second place. And
is there a bit of banter in the flat then leading up to today?
Oh no, we're pretty relaxed about it really. You know, we don't talk about, you know, we train and then we get on with life. We have each go to uni, and you know, we don't stick to running the whole time, which is nice.
Does it make it easier living with another athlete?
Yeah, definitely. I reckon, you know, those early mornings and hard training sessions, it's always good to have someone else in the household doing the same thing as you, and you know, or healthy eating and got the same mindset, so no, it's really good.
Saturday's effort was somewhat of a training run for Flanagan, who was off to Beijing to compete in the steeplechase at the World Track and Field Championships.
Really similar to a steeplechase actually, which is why I try and, you know, squeeze in a few cross-country races in between going overseas. And yeah, with the water jumps and the jumps and steeplechase, it always makes it that much more challenging, you know, fitness-wise, so cross-country is a great alternative.
The upcoming world champs aren't the only thing on her mind, though, with next year's Rio Olympics a realistic hope.
The aim is to, I'm trying to qualify for Rio next year, so either A or a B stand, qualifying stand would be awesome. So hoping to go out there and smash that, and, you know, even getting into the final would be amazing.
Earlier in the day, the Masters took on the 8-kilometre course, with age categories ranging from 35 to 39, all the way to 75 to 79. Canterbury's Chris Marden came home in second overall and took home the 40 to 44 age group gold medal. Chris put some of his success down to local knowledge.
Yeah, I'm a bit sneaky. I come out here and train every weekend before the cross country champs. But you might as well, because for the last 2 years it's been nationals. And the trick is to come out here, train out here and get some local knowledge.
That local knowledge wasn't enough for Canterbury in the team event though, coming second to Wellington by the slimmest of margins.
We got second on count back. We were on same on the points against Wellington, but our fourth runner came one place behind their fourth runner, and we were half a second in combined time ahead, but we got second. So over 32k of running combined, we were half a second faster.
They may have been half a second faster, but that wasn't bothering the Wellington team that we came across on our travels.
we've cleaned up. We like Canterbury. You give us all your medals.
Does that give you guys bragging rights for the next 12 months? I mean, do you guys know any of the guys in the Canterbury team well?
Yeah, yep. Yeah, we know them, and we will be exercising those bragging rights at every possible opportunity. we'll next bump into them at Road Champs, which are in Tauranga in about a month, and we'll just remind them of this day on their home turf.
Although they may not be as youthful as those competing in the under 15 or 13 events, the older competitors are as keen as any.
Yeah, the Masters will always be the first ones registered any time that the registration's open, and they're always looking for them to open up and get here. And they're a massive part of our sport, and it's fantastic to see. It's a lot of the same. There's a real core group of people that will come and run things. They'll run the New Zealand Half Marathon Champs, the Marathon Champs, the Cross Country, the Road Champs, the Road Relays. They're always there. There's some real characters and some people with massive history in our sport that are turning up and still running and still competing well and winning medals, and I guess it's testament to them and how much they love the sport as well.
Saturday could only be described as a success for the sport, but as always, it's something that could never be put together without the hard work of organisers.
It's a really great place to come and run a national championships because the Canterbury Centre is just so organised and put on a great spot. And the quarry here is a fantastic venue as well. So, everyone from the right around New Zealand love coming down here, and they know it's going to be a really organised and a really great event. So, good to see, and great to see good numbers down supporting.
Gordon Findlater for Canterbury Live.
There you go. Thanks so much, Gordon. And more of that story will be on at first at 5 tonight, so make sure you watch that. And it was held in the Hawswell Quarry, if you saw a familiar vision. Now, talking about vision, photography, a very important part of my next guest's world. Juliet Capaldi, welcome to Canterbury Live.
Hi, thanks, Andrew.
And Etta Photography.
Yeah, Etta Amateurs.
So, where does the name come from? I have to ask that because there's no Juliet and there's no Capaldi in there.
No,
so.
I was in South America for a couple of years, so Juliet became Julieta, so it's just the end of that. Yeah.
Oh, that's very cool. Yeah. So, you lived there?
Yeah, I was tour leader for 2 years, yeah.
Oh, what an awesome job.
It's amazing.
And now, incredible what you're doing now, though, with photography.
Yeah, I love it.
Is photography something you always wanted to do?
Yeah, probably from about 12, 14. I started having a camera and just practiced on my friends. So, I love photographing people. So, I just did my friends. And now I'm like my son, he's 5. He's my number one target.
While he's still a happy candidate. Yeah. What are some tips that you'd give parents on taking photos, because it's a different age now, isn't it?
Yeah, it's great with digital. I kind of think it's really good to plan beforehand, so think of the time of the day that they're in the best mood, best light and that sort of stuff, and sort of think what you want them to wear. Maybe have 2 outfits so you can say on the day, this one or this one. Mm. And then on the day, just totally not plan, so just let them be, just let them run or laugh or kick a ball. Don't make them try and sit in a chair and look at the camera or anything. Just let them be themselves.
And that's where you bring out the beauty, though, being a professional photographer. You know the little pressure points, I guess, with children especially.
Yeah, I just keep bringing in something new. I say, do you want to sit here? I'll bring out my princess chair in my studio. And they won't want to sit in it. They'll stand behind it and hide and peek out, and you get a gorgeous photo of them just playing around. So, you just sort of go with them. You just flow, you relax, and don't try and make them do anything because the kids, they won't.
Well, you've obviously got a very relaxed attitude to it, and I guess that's the key, isn't it? We've got some wonderful, just a small example though, of some of your beautiful photos. Let's have a look here. This is candid. This is nice.
Yeah, so that's the grandparents and their 4 grandchildren just having a big cuddle.
Isn't that cool?
Yeah, and this wee boy's about 6-8 weeks old, mum and dad.
A very unpredictable age.
Yeah. Father and son on the beach.
And this is it. We can get so many different shots on one day, can't you?
Yeah.
So mum and mum or dad, both together, the rest of the family.
Yeah.
This is very sweet, though. Is this Hagley Park or...?
That was Hagley Park by the netball courts. And this is Hagley Park, the little Hagley Park.
Right.
This wee man, he just liked playing with a stick, so we just let him. And his parents just adored having, him playing with a stick, because that's what he does.
And all those crunch of the leaves and that, the kids love that, don't they?
Yeah.
As well. You talked about clothing before.
Yeah.
Is there things, and I guess you'll educate us on, that you shouldn't wear in a photo?
You don't want to clash with each other, and you don't want to clash with the surroundings. So for these autumn leaves ones, I said to the mum, bring in browns, blues, that sort of colour, and she dressed them really well, so you don't even notice her clothes. So the main thing is you don't want to see Nike on the t-shirt, or you don't want to see bright...
Unless it's sponsored by Nike.
You don't want to see a bright fluoro green next to a bright red, that sort of thing. You want, you know, a mixture of tones that just naturally, you know, fit in with the surrounding.
Since the earthquake, Juliet, are you finding that people want to capture moments more?
Yeah, it's more important. Everyone's really just valuing their families so much more and just holding them close and appreciating it. So people were saying, yeah, I've got to capture this time, you know, so it's going to be there for all the generations.
One. Yeah, that's a bit sweet.
So again, it's three generations. Just he was 9 days old.
So is that dad, daughter and...
Grandchild.
This is my favourite. I've got a bit of a fave.
Yeah.
I love this, that the mum. Yeah. That laughter, looking out to the sea. I think it's just
This is up in my studio. I love it too. Oh. She just, the wave was about to come in and she just totally cracked up laughing and just having a great time. And the dog just came and stood there and it's just...
What a good dog.
Yeah. They just did what they wanted and then you're just there to capture it. Yeah.
It's just a bit of a privilege, isn't it, Juliet, for you?
Oh, I can't believe, you know, sometimes the experience I get to, you know, be in these special, special moments with these families.
So when we've decided that, okay, hello, we need to take time to actually have a family photograph, talk us through the process of it actually happening.
Yeah, so the main thing is to talk about before with your photographer, the sort of light, the sort of stuff you like. So do you like it studio, something a bit more formal, or really young kids are good in the studio, or do you want it natural, beach, trees, laughing, running, that sort of stuff? And then you talk about what sort of clothes to wear, so stuff that, you know, really is going to suit it. You know, there's different packages that you can go with, so, you know, you look at your budget and what sort of thing, and how much wall space you got, you know, do you just want one really big thing?
Yeah. Wall space.
Wall space, yeah.
Do you
just want one really big, you know, family portrait in the lounge, or do you want something for in the children's room? So the girls in the leaves, the mum got, you know, a set of three for each child, so it had the two sisters in the middle and then the child whose room it was on each side. So they've got something with themselves and their sibling that they're going to, you know, have for, you know, the next 50 years, and so they're going to have them in the bedrooms for now. So.
And you just capture something there, 50 years, if it's maybe a birthday or a date, that is the perfect time when you've got all the family together.
Yeah.
But people don't think about it and they go, oh, I didn't get a photo.
Yeah, so often you sort of do, like, you catch up with your photographer for an hour or two beforehand. So say you're having a big lunch because it's, you know, grandma's 90th birthday. Organise your photographer for an hour or two beforehand while everyone's fresh and makeup's looking good. Yep. Get some really stunning portraits. It's the perfect time.
See, she is just awesome, Juliet. She can educate you on what the best thing to do. So make sure you contact Juliet. Phone 027 257 023, I think it is. Yeah, itimages.co.nz. Too cool. Don't leave it too late. Now stay with us because after the break, on Friday, I caught up with the Pacifica and Māori Wardens, but the wonderful thing they're doing within our community. Well, kia ora and welcome back. And we are now joined by, look at this, bevy of bodies that are here doing amazing stuff in our community. So let's head off with, first of all, must be a great lady, Senior Constable Andrea Williams. Kia ora and welcome to Canterbury Live.
Te lo falava.
Yeah, te lo falava, exactly. And you're the Māori Pacific Liaison Officer, which is awesome. Next to you is Norm Jews, who's the CEO, love that name, of Te Runanga o Ngā Mata Waka. Kia ora.
Great.
Yes, correct. Thank you for that. And Earl Simpson, who's the Pacific Island Coordinator for the new wardens, this new incentive that's happening. Yeah, Bulawanaka. Good on you. And Sergeant Wayne Panapa, who's the National Trainer, of the Māori Wardens. Kia ora to you all and welcome.
Kia ora,
some great stuff happening, Andrea. Can you explain to us?
So our communities have been working in collaboration with police, and they have come up with an initiative to have Pacific ethnic Māori wardens out in the street. Our logo is Be Safe, Feel Safe, and that's our main aim, and to work together. So over the yesterday and today, we've got a whole range of ethnic Pacific and Māori wardens training at Nahawefa. Great initiative, working together, and we'll be working with community patrols and just getting out there and doing it.
It's wonderful. Norma, it must warm your heart to see all these communities come together. I mean, the Māori Wardens, I mean, they were a force, they are a force, so it must be great to pass it on to other communities.
Oh yes, it is. The The province of law and order is not just for Maori wardens, it's a responsibility of the whole community. And we're very grateful for our Pacific cousins and brothers and sisters wanting to come and join with us. And we're looking forward to working with them at many events.
Earl, how has your community embraced this, to take it on and bring out your own wardens for the community?
Well, I think they've always been supportive, and the Pacific wardens have been under the radar for a very long time. We're just so thankful that the Māori wardens have had the experience and the history, and so we've got a lot to learn from them. So, yeah.
Yeah, definitely. And Wayne, for you, you're the national trainer for the Māori wardens. How have things changed? If you can look back into modern day now.
If you look at policing, and Robert Peel said the police are the community, community are the police. And it was the initiative of the commissioner, former commissioner, that started this relationship in 2007.
So it's quite amazing, isn't it? Mm. And for you, Andrew, you're the liaison officer for all the... That's quite a big role. Are we in good spirits here in Canterbury?
Absolutely. I'm just lucky to have communities that actually want to be part of our prevention first policing. Our whole emphasis from policing has changed now to being preventative, being out there, stopping things before they create, to police being at the bottom of the hill.
Fluffy, isn't it? Yeah.
Cutting, yeah.
So, exactly.
So it's actually really fantastic. I love it. I love my job, and I work with some great people.
Yeah. Well, speaking of great people, Norm, that is the key, though, to find the right people, though, to have these roles as a warden.
Yes, it is, and it's only right that they get screened, they get vetted to make sure they're suitable, and they're right for the job, fit for purpose. Two of the most important ingredients for me is, one, having local iwi support throughout Te Wai Pounamu, and also having a collaborative approach with the New Zealand Police and other Crown agencies.
Right. And Earl, do you find with the Pacific community there is sometimes a language barrier, and that is where the wardens also do step in to be, you know, that person in between?
Yeah, absolutely, and I think that's definitely one of the strengths is having the language and the opportunity, because that helps to break down the relationships to be more effective in their role. But I think the aspect of it being a career path for young Pacific people into the police force, but also for some of our elders who want to give back to our community as well. Yeah.
And Wayne, that would be in essence probably a lot where the Māori wardens did come from. It was giving back to the community, wasn't it?
Yes, it is.
To give them a voice.
They'd started back in about 1854. They started, the wardens had started then. They're the only group that are mandated under legislation to work with Māori communities. And it's good to see how that our Pacific and other ethnic people are joining the fore, as they assisted us in the World Cup in 2011. You know, the language barrier and all that kind of stuff, teamed up with the police officers, branded with police, we are forced to reckon with.
Well, I congratulate you all. You're doing a wonderful thing for our community. You know, the biggest thing is actually talking and communicating, isn't it? And bringing those cultures together, because that's the beautiful thing about Aotearoa, is that we're all here as one, living together in this beautiful country. So congratulations. Look forward to hearing about all this good stuff that's coming out from the training in that.
Kia ora.
Thank you.
And from one beautiful community field to another, Phil Brady joins me now. How's the city mission going?
Oh, good, thanks, Andrea. Yes, we're really busy with collecting the food from the paper bag appeal, so that's going very, very well.
Are people still embracing that though, Phil?
Yes, they are, yes. There's been quite a bit of food come in. We get it coming on the truckload, actually, and on pallets, so it's going really well. So thank you for all the people out there that give so generously.
Yeah, and it doesn't take much, does it, to fill one of those bags? They're not like a huge paper bag. They're only about that.
That's right.
That tall. So yep. It doesn't take much to actually fill them with some goodies in there, is it? That's good.
It's great.
It warms the heart a little bit, doesn't it?
It does, yes.
Okay, mortgages.
Yes, we spoke about this last time.
We did. So what's the dealio?
Well, I think last time we spoke, we said, did the banks preempt the reduction?
Yes.
On the official cash rate, and did they get it right? Well, they did get it right. It went down by 25 points, but there are other reviews coming up in the next couple of months, one in September, one in October, and one in December. So the big question is, how far is the Reserve Bank prepared to bring down the official cash rate? Because if you're thinking about your mortgage, do you want to fix it now so that you can guarantee that say for the next 2 years you're going to be at 4.69 as one bank's offering. But I did see today that another bank's offering 4.69 for 1 year. So the question arose in my mind, what about 6 months?
We it's did a gamble though, isn't it?
It is. Years ago, banks did offer 6 month mortgages at fixed rates.
And will the other banks follow the other?
Reserve banks? If they feel that the competition is against them, yes, they will follow. So that's because this bank, I shouldn't use any bank's name, but this bank has obviously followed the BNZ, but taken a year off it, fixed it for 1 year rather than 2 years at 4.69. So,
which is attractive.
It is very attractive,
isn't it?
Yes.
Because then, as you said, things could change where it could get better.
Yes.
They could drop even further, and yay, we've only gone on for a year.
Yes.
That's basically what we're looking at.
That's right. Yeah. And that sort of gamble is worth it, in a way. Because over the last 15 years, the official cash rate has never dropped below 2.5. And now we've got it at 3, so there is a bit more movement, possibly. It depends what the government or Reserve Bank sees the economy doing. So, it's a real, have to have a real
but
think about that.
But who do you listen to, though?
You've got to listen to your own heart or your own mind.
Well, that's a bit deep and manual for a finance segment there. You've got to listen to your crikey.
Well, that's right, because you've got to know what's best for you, I guess. Because if you do fix it, now, you know that for the next year or 2 years that your interest rate is not going to move. Because generally, after an interest rate reduction, usually we do get some increases. But I noticed that for 3 years, from 2011 to 2014, the official cash rate was sitting at 2.5 for that period. So that's quite a big period where it's sitting at that quite low rate. So, yes, it's very much what's best for the borrower.
The other element of it, though, is if you are saving,
yes,
we should be saving that saving.
Yes, we should be saving
not
that savings.
Not reinvesting it in a new car.
That's true.
That's the danger, isn't it?
Yes, that's right. It depends on where a person is in their life. If you're coming up to retirement and you have got some spare cash, you might like to, improve your car. So it's very much what's best for us, what's best for the person, whether to borrow the money or take it out of savings, to buy a car.
Okay, next time, fortnight's time, what are we going to cover?
Well, we've talked about lending for the last two sessions. Let's talk about savings. Let's talk about preparing for retirement.
What?
KiwiSaver.
No, the government's going to look after us. Don't you know that?
I've heard that said before, Andrea.
Yeah.
So, no, we have to really think about
exactly.
it. And I've got some ideas you and I can share next time.
Okay, sounds good. Good
Great.
Seeing you, my friend.
Thank you very much.
Okay, rightio. Now stay with us because after the break, wonderful artist is joining me, George Arunui, with his beautiful art pieces. Love them. And kia ora to George Arunui. Welcome to Canterbury Live.
Kia ora.
This is making me smile because your art is lino cuts. And I remember doing them at school. There were no way anything like this.
Mm.
But is it old school, lino cuts?
No, I've been doing them for about 10 years.
Yeah.
I went to a course in Christchurch in about 10 years ago and started doing them there. And they're quite hard to do, but they're not too easy. They're quite easy as well, you see.
And I think it's a little bit dangerous too.
There are a few points you have to work on that with the tools, because you've got to work so that you're not pointing the tool toward yourself.
No.
You're working away from yourself.
Do you see where I was going with that? That I actually had a couple of cuts when I was doing it, so I didn't listen to the teacher at that point. You see.
No.
That was always my report. You see, is Andrew could give more attention to school. That's probably why I'm in television and talking for a living. That's an example. of one of the lino cuts there. Can you explain to us this piece?
This one is called Ra the Sun. It's basically a image of the sun when Maori, when the god Maui first started beating it, and the legend goes that he beat the sun so that it slowed down, and that's why we had daylight savings, you see.
Yes.
So that's part of it. Yeah.
That's beautiful. And where does your inspiration come through for your lino arts? We've got sections of images you've sent through of some of your pieces.
Yeah.
Where does it inner inspiration come through before you start?
Well, sometimes I do it first in pencil first. Mm-hmm. Usually I do. Usually something in front of me, but although that one there is not really something in front of me, but usually maybe something in front of me I might do. You know, like
sketching first, or
sometimes, yeah. Yeah. Oh, other times. Here.
So what did you say one before there was?
That's
was
a that's a lino cut. It's actually a maze, I think it's called. It's basically shapes done in different colours. You know, cutting out different areas of the picture and leaving, you know, knowing where to put the white and put the red and put the green and dark green in there.
It's quite dramatic, isn't
it? That's called the Gecko, the lino cut as well. The image is cut out, usually cut out, you cut out the image, and then when you want to print, you want to print different colours, you've got to repeat yourself, repeat the idea.
Oh, okay.
So, like if you want to do yellow on brown, like that one, usually you do yellow first and then and go darker.
There's definitely a trick to it, isn't there? It's manipulating those colours, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
Now, let's talk about the exhibition that is happening at the moment. It is being held at the East Side Gallery.
Linwood Community Arts Centre.
Yep. Yeah. And that's a corner of Stanmore and Worcester Street.
Yeah.
And you're doing this, though, with Dallas Matoi as well. So is he a partner in crime as far as the artwork,
we've only just met each other, you know, a couple of weeks back when the opening of the exhibition.
And art's drawn you together?
We've met, you know, we've got good ideas we share with each other, you know. For instance, a while ago I said to Moore, you know, if I give you a few cards, I want to swap you for one of your images. So he said, yes.
Oh, a bit of happening there. It's a bit of bartering, sorry. And you've even taken your artwork into your cards.
Business cards. They're some of them
lovely.
Are pastels. They're not all lino cuts. Most of them are pastels and lino cuts. This one here is called The Brothers, because, you know, you can see it's two men standing
together. Yeah, this other one here is just wonderful.
The other one, colours there. So those are cards, like, if you don't want an original, you don't have to use original. I usually sell my originals for about $100 or $200. Not too expensive. But
it's not expensive at all.
No, but if you don't want an original, you just buy a card.
Yeah. So let's go back to what you were just saying about buying. So all of the pieces, will they be available to purchase?
They will be, yeah.
Great.
Just gotta call me up. I'll usually give out business cards at Linwood Community Arts Centre.
Yeah, great.
There's a few business cards there, so people can grab hold of them.
And how big are the pieces then?
The original, usually about that size, actually. Right. Yeah.
So about that
Most
size
of them are about
a normal
that
piece
size.
Of art. Yeah. And do they come in a frame, or you have to frame
well,
it?
I frame most of them. Like the ones at the art exhibition, they're all framed. Usually I try and frame them, you know. Sometimes if I don't frame them, I don't have to charge you all that much for them, because the framing costs quite a lot, but a wee bit of money.
So what I'm getting at is that you can purchase and then take it straight through
straight
to your
home,
your business, and put it up. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
Oh, well, congratulations to you. Fantastic, fantastic what you are doing.
Yeah.
And remember, you can purchase any of these work. Just pop on down to the corner of Stanmore and Worcester Streets. Kia ora to you, George.
Cool.
All the best. Keep in
Thank
touch.
Yep.
Rightio. Now, on Wednesday show, remember, the new format is 1 hour, Monday and Wednesday, Canterbury Live. So we won't be there tomorrow, but back on Wednesday, we have Anthony Goff. What suit will the man be wearing? Sarah's Hero, Crafted Chickadee, and Phyllis Brown. Thank you so much for joining me today for the hour. It's been awesome, and awesome to my team that brought it all together today. Have a fantastic Monday. We'll do it all again on Wednesday. See you soon.
arms reaching, smiling sweetly. It's good to touch the green, green grass of home. The old house is still standing, though the paint is cracked and dry. And there's that old